So welcome to module 9.6, and in this we will see how we go about the final project 10 testing. So you would have generated two files. One is the JAC tokenizer and the JAC analyzer. So to this, so there are three directories in your project 10. One is this array test, square and expressionless square. You will see three directories as a part of your project 10: array test, expressionless square, and square, as you see here. So if you go into that array test, you will see you will actually see each one. You will see a main file, main.jack, main.t.xml, and main.xml. So you take this JAC tokenizer. To this JAC tokenizer, you give as input your main.jack, and this will give me, say, let me call it main.tok token. This and this main.t.xml should be the same. Now to this JAC analyzer, you give this main.tok as input. And this should give me, let us say it's going to give you some main.anz or whatever. This and this should be same. So if you are using Linux, you can use this diff command. Windows, I don't know. Windows, you can find similar command, but in Linux you can use diff command. And all these files are basically DOS files. So use this utility called DOS to Unix in Linux to convert this file. So it will remove all the DOS characters so that when you compare, they match, right? So in the case of square, you will actually see a main.jack, again main.t and main.t.xml, main.xml. Then you will also see a square.jack.xml, square.t.xml, and square.xml. You will also see a square game. .xml, square game t, square game dot jack, square game t dot xml, and square game dot xml. Okay, so three files, the same thing. So you have to compile each of these files with your JAC tokenizer and then analyzer, and then compare these two, as you see. And similarly, you have to do for the other thing. And similarly, you can do it for the expressionless square. So all these three, if you test and if the diff matches, that is, there is no difference, then you have got your tokenizer and analyzer in proper shape. So this is what is expected out of you as a part of project 10. And if you have any doubts, please do put on the discussion forum, and we will discuss that in greater depth there. So this is the part one, or what we call as the front end of your compiler, where you have taken the JAC representation and you have got an XML representation which can be used for generating the code. This XML representation is also called as an intermediate code, right? Now this intermediate code is now going to be taken to generate code for your virtual machine, right? So the interesting part now is, one of the things that we need to realize is that, so we introduced a notion of virtual machine to support several hardware architectures, right? And so several programming languages can be there. So this is what was our earlier notion of virtual machine. If you go back to the earlier module, some of the introduction. So I could have k different programming languages on n different hardware. I have a common virtual machine. So I write a compiler for this, and then an interpreter for this, and it's done. So whenever I introduce a new hardware, say H-N or HN+1, I need to write a compiler for this. I need to just write an interpreter for this. When I introduce, then if I write an interpreter, all these programming languages can start working on this. And similarly, if I introduce one PLN+1, I need to write a compiler for this, then all the hardware here can basically execute. That's the notion of this virtual machine. Now, suppose I have two virtual machines, VM1 and VM2, right? Now, this compiler, what it does, it takes the high level language and it has got me a .xml based intermediate representation. From there, I am going to get a .vm file, which is the, now this two, so this is called the front end as I mentioned earlier, this is called the back end. So, if I am introducing two virtual machines, when I want this PL1 to execute on VM2 or VM1, the only thing I need to change is only the back end. The front end can remain the same. So, there is a front end, there is a back end now. So, let us say, let us put another virtual machine here, VM2. Now, this program should run on the VM2. I need to take this back end alone and change. For every one of this programming language, the front end can remain the same, only the back end I need to change for this VM2. So, that is a major effort. So, now we have got two projects, right? Project 10 and 11 for doing this. For every time I introduce a new virtual machine, only the project 11 has to be, whatever you are going to discuss next is going need to be done, the other part need not be done. So there is the compiler now itself has two parts. One is the virtual machine independent part, which is the front end, and the virtual machine dependent part. So, by doing this separation of virtual machine independent and dependent, for me to port the compilers across different virtual machines become extremely easy. So, that is the good thing about compilers. So, I hope you have, if you actually finish off this part, what normally is there in many of the curriculum across different universities of compiler, which basically stops with intermediate code generation, that you have done within this 2 weeks. Now, you have understood quite a bit of that. So, try and put that effort so that you are very clear of how compiler indeed works. There are a lot to learn in compilers, but nevertheless, this is a very good starting point. I hope it will serve as a very good starting point for you, right. So, we will now start looking at the code generation in the next module 10. Thank you.